Welcome to Concepts of Programming Languages. In this video, I want to talk about variables and their declarations, that variables store values, and how long these variables store values, that is called their lifetimes, the notion of garbage collection, and I will shortly say something about value sharing. So let's get started. So a variable declaration you can put in programming languages in the text to declare the existence of a variable, so to say. And a variable declaration, it consists of the name of the variable that you intend to declare. But moreover, you can annotate the declaration with attributes. And in the previous video, you have seen some attributes, such as data type or the initial value of a variable. But moreover, you can annotate a variable declaration by the storage location. In some programming languages, like for instance Rust, the notion of lifetimes of a variable is also explicit in a variable declaration. So, once you have a variable declaration, and this is an example of it, it declares a variable with the name x, with the data type int, say the mathematical integers, and the initial value 5. And you could understand variable declarations as being given explicitly so that you can find the variable declaration in the program text, or implicitly, and then the variable declarations are not visible in the program text. And now these explicit variable declarations are typically either all on the top of the program, that you declare what variables the program operates on, but also it is most programming languages support that you can declare variables within a code block. An example of a variable declaration within a code block looks like this. So here you have a code block with these braces. And then first of all, you declare a variable, say with x, with initial value 5. And then the contents of the code block follow. So in this case, we have a print command. So for what do you use variable declarations? Well, if you want to use variables in your programs, it is useful to understand what kind of variable you want to use. And that's why you declare it, so that you can associate the attributes to the variable. I can give you now some examples of how variable occurrences in the text relate to variable declarations. And this notion of, it's called variable binding, is very similar to what we've seen already before in the case of the lambda calculus. There you also had variable occurrences, which are then bound by their nearest abstraction. So this concept now you see in a different form how it is used in most programming languages, or at least most imperative programming languages. You could ask yourself, okay, if I have a variable occurrence somewhere in my text, in my program text, to what variable is that variable occurrence then bound? Well, there are two kinds of variable declarations. Those that are all the top of the program, those you call global variable declarations, and those that are put within a code block, and those you call local variable declarations. So here you see an example, say, of a program in which you declare globally the variable y. That is this declaration here. And then you say, oh, I have a procedure with the name p, and it has as a procedure body this code block here. And then I have a variable declaration at the beginning of the code block. So this is a local variable declaration, and this is a global variable declaration. And now, just like variable binding, as discussed before, you can also understand that the variable occurrences in the program text are now bound to a variable. So for instance, whenever you see this x here, of the print x command, then you can ask yourself, well, to what x is this variable occurrence To what variable is this variable occurrence bound? Well, it turns out that this declaration here, it's the nearest declaration that you can find. So this variable occurrence is bound to the same variable as that is declared here locally. And then whenever you have, for instance, an assignment command, the variable on the left-hand side of the assignment is also bound to the same declaration, so to the same variable declared here. And on the right-hand side, we also have a variable occurrence x. It's also bound to the same variable. But in the last print command, you see an x, and this x is all bound to the same variable, but you also see a y. And this y is not declared locally in the code block here. So this y, it finds the nearest declaration, but it is not within the code block that is presented here. So this y is then bound to the global variable declaration that is here, to the global variable that is declared here. So to understand, suppose you would call the procedure P, what would this then do? Well, we have the first command in its body is to print x, and the x has initial value 5. So whenever you call this procedure P, the first thing you would see is that it outputs 5. And then it would assign x to the value x plus 5, well, and x will add the value 5, so it now gets the value 10. And in the next command, you then print 10 plus, and then what is the value of y? Well, it was declared globally, and it has also the value 5. So then you get 10 plus 5, 15. So that is what this program then does. Okay, but there are some intricate but interesting notions when you talk about variables and variable declarations. One of them is the question when variables are bound. So just what I showed you was the binding process that could all happen just on the program text. And whenever that happens, you can speak of static variable binding. It is called static because you could do it even before you start running the program. So all the variable occurrences are known to be bound to a particular variable declaration, and this can be done statically. So, to give you another example of how this variable binding works, you see here a global variable declaration, and here you see a local variable declaration, but here you also see a local variable declaration. So now, to what variables are the occurrences bound? So this x, this variable occurrence x, it is bound to the local variable declaration that is here. And this variable occurrence y, it is bound to the global variable y that is declared over here. But now, whenever you have the procedure q, it also it declares locally the variable y. So if you now try to understand what would happen if you would call procedure q, well, then you would execute its body p. And whenever you execute the body p, well, then you would print x plus y. But now when I say that the variables are bound statically, then this y is bound to the global variable declaration y over here, although at runtime we have that the y that is declared locally over here happens first in some sense, because we execute q first and then go into p. But now in static variable binding, it is known already before the program executes to what variable declaration each variable occurrence is bound. So contrasting to static variable binding, there is also this notion of dynamic variable binding. And dynamic variable binding delegates the variable binding process to the latest moment at runtime. So it is not the case that the variables are bound before running the program. No, they are bound on the fly. And to give you an example of how that works, consider the following example. Here we have a global variable declaration y, and we have a local variable declaration x over here. But now, in the procedure q, we have a dynamic local variable declaration y. So this one declares that y is a local variable in the body of q, and whenever we then execute the procedure p within the context of this local dynamically local variable declaration of y, then whenever we execute p and we try to understand to what is this variable x bound, well, it's statically, it's local, but to what is this y bound, it is no longer bound to the global variable that is declared here. No, it is bound as if it was captured by the local variable declaration over here. So you could almost understand this by if you substitute the body of p at the place where we call it, then the variable y then from that point on finds the nearest local variable declaration. So I write it like this to indicate that this is dynamically capturing the local variable declaration. If we go back to the previous example, then whenever you substitute p for its body, then it has a different meaning, because then the nearest y to which this variable would be bound would become this local variable that is declared over here, and then you get a capture, you get a variable capture. If you imagine that this p was replaced by this code block over here, and then you try to understand to what is this variable y bound, well, then you can sort of walk up in sort of the program context, and then you would find that the nearest declaration would be this. But that is not what happens in static variable binding. In static variable binding, you do not consider the dynamic behavior of a program, and instead you make use of the so-called lexical scope. And a lexical scope is the context, so the program text that directly surrounds it. So in static variable binding, this y, you try to bind it statically by looking around in the context, and then the nearest binding site would be this global variable declaration. Whereas with dynamic variable binding, this y here is captured by this local variable declaration. That changes then the variable to what this y, what the intended variable is that this y here refers to. Okay, so that is static and variable dynamic, static and dynamic variable binding. What can you say more about variable bindings? Well, there is this notion of visibility. So if you look at a particular variable occurrence as it occurs in the program text, then you can ask yourself, okay, what other variables are visible at this point in the text? And whenever you talk about that, this is typically called the variable context or the environment. Now, whenever you speak about environments, it is you indicate a position in the program text and you ask yourself, well, what are all the variables that are now visible? So suppose I would place a variable occurrence at this point, to what variables could it all be bound? I will show you an example later. But moreover, there is also this notion of variable shadowing. You could imagine that as soon as you have a variable occurrence, that you try to look in the context of the program, where is that variable declared? And then you find the nearest declaration. But now, whenever there are nested declarations of the same name, then the nearest declaration causes the further, the declaration that are further away to be cast in shadow. They're no longer visible from the point of where you would want to perform the variable binding. So let me give you a concrete example of that. Here you see, let's assume static variable binding here. Here you see a program that consists of an outer block, that's this one here, where we have the local variable declaration of the variable y. And then we have a print, and print command, and the print takes an x and a y. Well, you could ask yourself, well, to what is this y bound? Well, you look in the enclosing text and you see, well, the nearest declaration is the one over here. So this y is bound to this declaration. Eh? They're bound to the same variable. But to what is x bound? Well, x is not anywhere in this code block, so you could call x a free variable. Eh? This is similar to what happens in the lambda calculus. And most likely in programming languages, free variables are either giving an implicit variable declaration, eh? But it depends on the programming language, or it will result in an error whenever you try to compile the program. Eh? Then it says, hey, you have a variable occurrence here, but I could not bind it to any variable declaration in its context. Okay, now suppose we now look at the next code block. That's the code block over here. And that starts with the variable declaration, local variable declaration for x. So when you look at the print command x plus y here, then you can ask yourself, well, to what is this variable occurrence x bound? Well, it's the nearest declaration. Eh? So in that case, this is the nearest declaration of the variable with the same name. So this x is bound by this to this variable, the variable declared over here. But then this variable occurrence y, to what is that bound? Well, you look in the context, so the program text that surrounds y, and what you see is, well, this is a variable declaration, but it has a different name. It's a name x, and that's not y. So you skip over it and you go to the next variable declaration, and then you see, oh, I have a variable declaration y here. So we can say that this variable occurrence y is bound to the variable declared over here. Now look at the next code block, which is the code block over here. And this code block is now redeclaring a variable with the name y. We already had a variable declaration over here with the name y, but here we redeclare a variable with the name y. So now whenever we ask ourselves, well, to how can we do the variable binding for this expression over here? Well, y is now bound to the variable declaration that is the nearest in its context, so in the program text that surrounds it. So this y is bound by the declaration over here. And it is not bound to the declaration over here. So you could say that this declaration overshadows, or it causes a shadow to be cast on this variable declaration. Eh? Because at this point here, no longer by referring to y, you can access this variable declared here. Instead, it is that all the occurrences of y are bound to the variable declared here. And x, of course, is still bound to the declaration over here. Okay, so that explains you the concept of variable shadowing. So that at every possible position in the program text, you can ask yourself, well, what variables are in my context? And so in the outer context, so let's say after this code block, there are no variables in context. And because there is no surrounding, there is in the context, there is no declaration that is visible from that point. And now suppose we go into this code block, you can ask yourself, well, at this point or at this point, what variables are visible over here? Well, that is y, because y here is so-called in scope. But if we go to the next code block that is nested, and we ask ourselves at this point what variables are visible, well, it is both y and x. And that's visible over here. And if you go into the deeply nested code block, and you ask yourself of a position over here or there, what variables are visible here? It's still x and y. But these x and this y that is visible over here is a different variable than the y that is visible over here. Because the y that is visible over here refers to the variable declared here, while the y that is visible over here refers to the variable declared over here. Okay, so that is variable visibility. So an important question you could ask yourself is, where do we store the values that are associated to variables? So remember that a state of whenever you execute a program, you do this by having a particular state of the variables, or to be precise, a state is an assignment from variables to values. But where do you actually store these values? Because a digital computer has the memory, and you would expect that the values, being digitally encodable, are somewhere in memory. So where in memory can you find your values that are associated to the variables? Well, there could be different choices where you store the value of a particular variable. And so you could imagine that you have the, in a von Neumann computer, you have the registers. The registers are very temporary storage of values. And now a particular variable could be stored, the value of a particular variable could be stored in a register. Alternatively, you could have the stack. And this is, say, a stack of maybe temporary values. And there you could also store the value of a particular variable. Or you have that the value of a variable is stored in memory, or in main memory. And this is also sometimes called in the heap. So these are the typical storage locations for values that are assigned to variables. And now sometimes it is possible, for instance, in the C programming language, it is possible to annotate variable declarations to require, for instance, that a variable's value must be stored, say, in a register. So you could annotate a declaration, a variable declaration, and then state, in the execution of this program, I require that the value of this variable must be stored within a register. But considering that most computers only have finitely many registers, so say you have maybe 10 or 16 registers available, as soon as you have programs which make use of more variables than there are registers, it is no longer possible to store the value of those variables all in a register, because there are not enough registers then. So in that case, you may use the memory of the computer to store the value. And the memory is typically divided into the main memory that is accessible, or special segment of the memory that is called the stack. But both the stack and the main memory are external to the processor. It's an external device where this value is stored. It's not in a register. Okay, so when do you know, when you write a piece of, whenever you write a program or a piece of a program, and you make variable declarations, when do you know what is the storage location for each variable? When do you know that? Well, that you could know statically. So that means that if you just look at the program text, then you know, this variable, statically, I can determine that this variable is stored somewhere. For instance, by annotating a variable declaration, by requiring it that it must be stored in a register, say. Or alternatively, you could it, but let's come back to other ways of storage. I first maybe want to give you an example of static storage. So typically, global variables, so the global variable declaration that you see over here, are the location in which the value is stored can be determined statically. Because the number of global variables is fixed, because in a program you typically declare the global variables at once, and then you know where the variables' values are stored. It is also possible to declare a local variable that it has to have static storage, and in that case you can also already reserve a location somewhere in memory in which the value of that variable is stored. And now it's interesting, because if you have static local variables, because the storage location is statically determined, it is also fixed over the course of an execution of the program. So if you consider this program as a whole, we have the global variable y and we have the local variable x over here. But this local variable x has static storage. So then whenever you execute the procedure p for the first time, then you can assume that x has its initial value 5. So whenever you print x, then you print 5. But then you modify the local variable x by assigning it to the value 5 plus 5. So then it becomes 10. But this value is stored in this statically determined location. So the next time you then execute the procedure p, then it is no longer the case that x has the value 5. Because the previous call to p has changed the value associated to the variable x, it is now the case, the second time you call p, that the value is 10. So whenever you print it, you will see the value 10. And it is then updated to the value 15. So the third time you call it, you would see that the local variable x then has value 15. What this also nicely demonstrates is that the storage location on the one hand and whether a variable declaration is local or global on the other hand are orthogonal concepts. Because you could have a global variable that has not a static storage location. There are programming languages where it is not statically determined where global variables are stored, but that it only at runtime dynamically chooses a storage location. But you could also have, just as what I explained in this example, have a global variable declaration which has a static storage location. And also it is possible to have a local variable that has static storage. Or you can have a local variable that not has static storage. So then the storage location is determined dynamically. So talking about determining dynamically the storage location of a variable, let's look at that now. So if the storage location is not statically known, you could call it that the variable has dynamic storage, or dynamic storage location. To give you an example of that, consider the following program. In this program, I declare a global variable y, and its initial value is 5. And I declare the local variable x, and its initial value is y plus 5. I then have an if command, which tests whether y is positive. And if that is the case, then it assigns y to 0 and it calls the procedure p recursively. And after that, it will print x plus y. So now let's try to imagine how the execution of the of a call to the procedure p looks like. So initially, the global variable has the value 5. And now suppose that we enter p for the first time. And so we call p. Then we locally store in the variable x the value 5 plus 5 is 10. Since the global variable has value 5, which is positive, we enter the body of the if. And now we modify the global variable to be 0. But now we call the procedure p. But think of it. So we now enter the procedure p for the second time. But we now have a local declaration of the variable x. But this is now a different variable. So this requires a different storage location for its value. And what is the value of x the second time we enter p? Well, now y has the value 0. Because we updated it previously. So now this x variable, the local variable x, has value 5. Since y is 0, the test is negative, so we do not enter the if body and we go to the print. So what do we print? We print 5, because that's the value of our local variable, plus 0. So we print 5, and then we reach the end of the procedure body. Whenever we reach the end of the procedure body, we have to return where we called our procedure. Well, that was in this case another procedure invocation. We were still over here. But over here, our variable x had a different value. So whenever we then exit the if body and we do the print command, y is still of value 0, but what is now the value of x? The value of x in this first call to p still had its original value, namely 10. So the second time we reach this print statement, the value that is printed is 10 and not 5. And as you can now imagine, we have reused the same variable name that was declared locally, but actually they represent different variables because the variables are stored at different places. And the storage location is determined dynamically. So to ask, to maybe answer the question you might have, where do you store these local variables then? Well, a typical place to store them is in the activation record of the procedure call. And the management of these storage locations, you could then understand to be either done fully automatic, like I already explained to you that, for instance, global variables would have automatically assigned a location in some programming languages, statically. But then dynamically, you could also have automatic storage location management by, for instance, recording these local variables in the activation record, the most recent activation record of a procedure call. Alternatively, it is also possible to perform the management of storage of values manually. And this is called manual memory management. And in that case, you have to yourself allocate storage locations for the duration that you need to store a value. And this duration in which you need to store a value is also called the storage lifetime. You can imagine that if you need to store a value only for a particular amount of time, that after that time, you could then repurpose the memory and then store a different value in it. Now, to obtain a memory location, this is called allocation. And to release a memory location, it's called deallocation. So there is, in the implementation of programming languages, a particular bookkeeping structure that will help with managing these storage locations. And this structure is typically a heap structure. So that is why sometimes the main memory is also called heap memory, because it is the bookkeeping structure of what storage locations are available for use that are stored in this heap. And now whenever you no longer need a storage location because you're done, say, with a particular computation, you can then return that storage location back to this, you can release your so-called ownership of that storage location, and then maybe later it can be reused, the same location, to store a different value with a different purpose. Okay, I'll give you an example program that does manual memory management here. So this is a procedure P with the following body. So you can see that in these variable declarations, in certain programming languages, you can also annotate the variable declaration, indicating that the variable makes use of manual storage management. And this is typically called pointer. So what can you then understand a pointer? Well, a pointer is basically pointing in memory, saying the value of this variable can be found by jumping through this pointer. And then at that address of the memory, the value must be stored. So then you see here, over here, we have a special expression. This is called new, which performs an allocation. What does the new allocate? Well, the new allocates sufficiently enough storage room so that you can store, for instance, the integer value 5. Okay, so what is then x? X is then an indirect variable, because the variable itself is storing a pointer to another variable in which the value actually is stored. In this case, the value 5 is stored somewhere in main memory. And now, for instance, the pointer x can be stored, say, in a register. And then in the register, the address of some location in memory where the value 5 is stored is stored. And you could have, for instance, multiple variables. So in this case, we have the variable x and the variable y, which are both pointers, and they point then to the same location in memory. That is what you obtain here. So then, whenever you want to print, you can print either the address itself, or in this case, I put the star in front of the variable occurrence to indicate a so-called dereferencing. And so dereferencing means, no, I don't want to print the address of where the value is stored. No, I want to follow that address and obtain the value that is stored in memory at that address. And this is called dereferencing. So by printing the dereference of the pointer x, I then print the value that is stored in memory at that address. And now it is the case that through this alias of the same variable, I could now change the value that is stored in memory. So for instance, through y, which is an alias of x, I could change the contents, the value that is stored in memory, to say the value 10 instead of 5. So by performing this assignment, I leave, of course, the address that is stored in y the same, but I change the value that is stored at that address in main memory by changing it from 5 to 10. So now when I, since x and y have the same address value, whenever I dereference now x again, I will now print out not 5, the previous value. No, I now print out 10, because the assignment here has changed the memory contents. And then afterwards, I then delete x. And by delete x, what I do, I deallocate the storage so that it then later can be repurposed whenever someone again performs a new to request some storage. So then the structure, the data structure that is typically supplied by the programming language implementation for managing the address space, for managing what addresses are still unused and what addresses are in use, I can use a heap structure. Okay. Now, there are some potential issues whenever you do manual storage management. And I will name two of them that are quite important. So one issue is the issue of dangling pointers, as it is called. And another issue is the issue of memory leaks, as it is called. And these days, where security of computers become more and more important, it is important that whenever you use manual storage management, that you avoid these issues. Why? Well, let me explain to you first what dangling pointers and memory leaks are. So here you see an example program in which I globally declare an indirect variable. Let me call the indirect variable y. And here you see something that is called a null pointer. It is basically a default address, an address on which no value is stored, and it is never valid to dereference the null pointer. You might get a segmentation fault whenever you use a low-level programming language, or you get a null pointer exception in Java, say. Because whenever you dereference an address that is an invalid address, because it doesn't even exist in memory, say, that is clearly an error, and then your program crashes. Okay, so this default value null is typically used to discriminate the two cases whether a pointer points to a valid memory address that was previously allocated or whether that has not yet been done. Now consider the procedure P, suppose that we would have called P. And we declare locally the variable, indirect variable x, to which is its initial value assigned, some address in the main memory that is allocated, in which the value 5 in main memory is stored. Next, we then assign to the address y, you could say, the indirect variable y, the address x. So it is now the case that both x and y, after executing this assignment, they are both storing the same address. And it's the same address in memory in which the value 5 is still stored. So whenever I now dereference x, I expect indeed the value 5 to be printed. Next, I assign the value that the indirect variable y points to in main memory, the value 10. So I update this location in main memory that we previously allocated, and I change the value from 5 to value 10. So it is now also the case that the alias, so the indirect variable x, that still points to the same variable as y does. Now also, if you would have printed the dereference of x, it would now then print 10. But instead of doing that, this program then allocates a new storage location, again with the value 5. So whenever we then print x, this x is now pointing to a different memory location than y did. So then whenever we print x now, we print the new address, this new location we have allocated over here, so it would print 5. But still, it is the case that the address y points to, that still has the value in main memory 10. Okay, so then after printing this new memory location, if we then deallocate the memory that we have obtained and previously stored in Y, then we release that memory back to the heap and we return from the procedure. But now there are two issues. One is a dangling pointer and one is a memory leak. Because what is the dangling pointer? Let me think of that. Yes. So the dangling pointer is that the global variable y still points to the storage location that was returned to the heap over here. By deleting, deallocating y, it could be possible later that the same storage location is repurposed. But we still have in our global variable y the address stored. So what if someone dereferences y then after we had deleted and deallocated its storage location? Well, then the storage location could have been repurposed and therefore reused for some other purpose while we still have access to it through the global variable y. So this is then called a dangling pointer. So y is pointing to something, but it does not have any reasonable, it doesn't have a good reason to point to it still. And we also here have a memory leak. And why is that the case? Well, consider counting how many times in the procedure P we have requested storage. We have requested storage twice, but we have returned storage only once. So that means that every time we call P, more and more and more storage is requested, but this storage is never returned back to the heap. It's never deallocated. So why are dangling pointers and memory leaks potential issues? And then from the perspective of, say, security, it is actually the following. Dangling pointers may be misused because you now can access memory that that there is no good reason why you could still access it. So suppose, for instance, you would have stored, say, your password somewhere, and now you have a pointer to it, and then you delete the storage location, then most likely the password is still stored in memory over there. But now you expect then the pointer to point to, well, still the same address. So then later on in the program, you could still retrieve the information that was stored at that address. And that is a potential risk. Now, why are memory leaks potential issues from the security perspective? Well, because it could exhaust the amount of resources, memory resources, that are available. And this could potentially lead to a denial of service situation where in which a program would crash because at some point it does no longer have any space available for allocating new storage locations. And both issues are kind of important. So these days there are more advanced programming languages in which you do not do manual storage management, or if you do manual storage management, that then the compiler statically tries to check whether these issues cannot occur. And this significantly improves the quality of the programs, because then these kinds of issues no longer occur. And one potential way of dealing with these issues is the use of garbage collection. And this is for instance implemented in a language like Java or C Sharp. So in a garbage collected programming language, you typically have the potential to allocate manually memory. So it is possible to obtain new memory, new storage locations by issuing this new. But it is implicit that the deallocation of the memory happens. And what does that mean? It is not required and even forbidden for the programmer to explicitly deallocate memory. So it is all left automatically to deallocate unused memory. But what do I mean with unused? Well, and this is where the garbage collector comes in. You could imagine that you have reserved a lot of space in memory, and then you have addresses pointing to that space in memory. But then, whenever you no longer are able to refer to the memory, because there are no longer any pointers to your memory, then you could call that memory that was reserved, you could call garbage. Because the program no longer stores anywhere in its variables an address to that memory. So that means that the memory is so-called unreachable from any of the variables that the program has access to still. Which then means that the contents of that storage could be cleaned up. And then the storage could be deallocated and repurposed for the different use later on. So to understand garbage collection on a quite abstract level, but sufficient for understanding it, you could think of it as some kind of background process that keeps on running while your program is also running. And this background process, it determines which part of the storage locations are no longer reachable. So that means that it is no longer possible from variables to which the program has access, so from which the program can read the values, there exists no pointer anymore whatsoever to the memory locations. And then you could consider these locations as garbage. It doesn't really matter what is their value because they cannot influence the outcome of the program anymore. Well, and as soon as you know what are the locations that are garbage, well, then you can clean up the garbage and you could deallocate the locations, making them available again for using them for a different purpose. So, practically speaking, there are different kinds of techniques. I will not go into the details of these techniques. They are quite interesting topics themselves, but you could study them further by yourself. But at least I want to talk about how they are called. One is reference counting, and the other is called the mark and sweep garbage collector. And you could understand reference counter as if you count how many pointers there are still to a memory location, as soon as that reaches zero, each time the memory location, each time a pointer is, for instance, assigned, you can decrease the count to the previous value by one. So then the active number of pointers into a memory region, you could call it count. And then whenever that reaches zero, then obviously the value can no longer influence the outcome of the program. Alternative technique for garbage collection is called mark and sweep. And what that does is that the background process that runs will basically scan over the whole memory, and it will try to determine what locations are still reachable. And after scanning the whole memory, and it has after marking which locations are still reachable, then it can again go over all of the memory and then clean up everything that is no longer reachable. But this, anyway, these are quite interesting topics themselves. But we will not go into that further now. Finally, let's consider the notion of value sharing. So, in a previous video, you have seen the existence of simple and complex data types that potentially has infinitely many values. And now I here say potentially, because in a previous video, I assumed sort of a Platonistic world in which every value is a timeless objective entity without any physical without any relation to physical manifestation or whatsoever. Although this is nice conceptually, practically it's not very nice, because values have to be stored. Computers are physical devices, and these physical devices have a limited storage capability. So since a computer has a limited storage capability, how can you then have infinitely many values? Well, the trick there is you don't. You do not have infinitely many values. You only have those values that are physically manifested in memory, those values that you need, or those values that you use. And all other infinitely many variables, they don't exist. Okay, and that might give you then an idea how to implement infinite data types. Why? Well, you can use the memory, and then use certain regions of the memory only for the values that a program currently, say, stores in its variables. And then as soon as a new value is computed, you would then reserve a new kind, allocate a new kind, a new storage location in which the new value is stored. And as soon as a value is no longer used, by that I mean as soon as a value is no longer assigned to any variable, it's garbage, and you can clean it up. And this way you could reuse the storage of the previous value, maybe to store a new computed value. And this way you could pretend the existence of infinitely many values while they are created on the fly. Okay. But now, what is then this notion of value sharing? Well, if you would have for every value reserved its own memory space, and then you lazily compute new values and store them again in memory space, what if you compute and the computed outcome is the same as a value that was already stored? Well, then it might, from an economical perspective, be cheaper, or it requires less storage if you could reuse values that are already stored in memory. Well, and for that you can then imagine algorithms that exist that reuse values already previously computed and constructed that are in memory. But then there are potential issues, namely, what if you have stored a value in a memory location, so it's a storage location in the main memory, and then you use that value, and then you have shared that value among different places, but then you want to change the value, Well, you can't change values from this Platonic point of view because values are objective, timeless entities. You can't have change if you change requires time. So, what does changing a value then mean? Well, you can't change values, but you can change the storage locations. So, the current value that is stored somewhere in memory could change over time. And as soon as you do that, well, then you can talk about as if the value was modified, as if you mutated the value. What you actually do is you take out the old value and you put in a new value. But now, whenever there was sharing, which means that the previous value was also used in different places, for instance, by pointing to the previous value, this mutation then causes the other memory locations that point to this to have a new meaning, and that is problematic. Okay, this discussion might sound a little bit abstract, but in a future video we will come back to this. Anyway, I want to say there are different ways of implementing these values, especially if you have infinite data types. One way of implementing values is to have sort of a pre-allocated pool of values, where the values are already there. Well, this obviously cannot be done if the data type is infinite, because you can't have infinitely many storage locations. Every computer always has finite memory, always has access to finitely many memory at a time. So this only works for finite data types. But there it kind of works nicely. For instance, you could imagine that you store, say, tables, lookup tables that never change over time. Well, you could store that statically in memory. An alternative way of implementing values is that you ensure that every value that you have computed on the fly, for instance, is stored in its own copy in memory. So for every possible value you would have computed, you reserve separate space. But this is, of course, very inefficient. And then to deal with that inefficiency, there is this notion of sharing values. But I already explained to you that sharing values brings its own problems with it, especially whenever you mutate values, or at least the storage location in which values are stored. Okay, but to that advanced topic, we will come back in a future video whenever we are discussing object orientation, because from that context, whenever I introduce object-oriented programming, it can be explained very nicely what this value sharing now precisely is. So we come back to that later. Thank you for watching this video, and I hope to see you soon again.